Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Shucked Apart by Barbara Ross, narrated by Dara Rosenberg. Chapter 1. Julia, meet my friend Andie. My boyfriend Chris, looking tasseled and handsome as always, stood in the doorway of my office. He entered the room, confident and casual, and a pleasant-looking woman followed.
You mean Andie from your poker nights?
I put my hand out to cover my confusion. For 2 years, I'd been laboring under the misapprehension that Andie was a man.
No, we haven't.
I'm Julia. She took my hand and shook. Andie, Greatorex, so glad to finally meet. Her handshake was firm and strong, which seemed right given her looks. She was tall, broad-shouldered, and obviously fit. Her sandy blonde hair, pulled back in a high ponytail, framed a round face with wide-set hazel eyes. She appeared to be in her mid-30s, like Chris and me. Also, like Chris and me, she wore jeans, work boots, a t-shirt, and a plaid flannel overshirt, as if we were planning on starting our own grunge band. Andie's t-shirt was maroon and had the words, "Great River Oysters" on it in white block letters. My t-shirt was navy and said "Snowden Family Clambake." Chris doesn't wear advertising, quote unquote, so his t-shirt was blank. In other words, we were dressed appropriately for a morning in coastal Maine in mid-May. Outside, pre-season tourists from away wore jackets and windbreakers, but we natives were hardier. I looked from Chris to Andie and back again, wondering why they were here. It could have been an informal visit, Chris running into Andie on the street and spontaneously deciding to bring her to meet me in the second floor office in my mother's house, where I ran our clambake business. Somehow, I doubted it. He took a step forward and spoke.
I invited Andie today because she has a problem, and we wondered if you could help.
I was intrigued. Please, sit. They sat in the two wooden guest chairs on the other side of the big mahogany desk that had been my late father's when he ran the business. The office was large and light. Three windows across the front of the house allowed me to look down the hill to the town pier, where our ticket kiosk stood, and where our tour boat, the Jackie 2, was docked waiting for customers who would start coming Memorial Day weekend. I hadn't changed a thing about the room since my dad had died. It still had the metal file cabinets in the corner and the big prints of sailing ships on the walls. "How can I help?" I asked. Andie glanced at Chris for encouragement and then began. "I was robbed yesterday." "That's terrible." Busman's Harbor was a place where people left keys in their vehicles and the doors to their homes unlocked. But we weren't immune from the scourge of drug addiction that plagued the rest of the country and the petty theft that went with it.
"She was attacked and then robbed," Chris clarified.
That was different and far, far more unusual.
"How awful. I am so sorry."
I looked into Andie's lightly freckled face. She didn't seem the worse for wear, no scratches or bruises. I felt badly for her, but I didn't see what it had to do with me. Andie cleared her throat. "Chris has talked at poker many times about how you've helped the police solve crimes. He's proud of you." She smiled at Chris, who beamed at me. He wasn't one to parade his feelings around, and I felt a warm glow creeping up my neck into my face. Where was this going? "And when this happened, I thought maybe you could help. So I called Chris, and here we are." Questions and more questions. "What was stolen?" I expected an answer like cash, credit cards, phone. "Two buckets of oyster spat."
"What the what? Spat?"
Andie smiled and her shoulders dropped into a more relaxed position. "Two big white pails of oyster seed, teeny tiny baby oysters. I run the Great River Oyster Farm on the Damariscotta River. I bought the seed from the hatchery and was carrying the buckets from my truck to my dock when it happened."
Oyster seed. That was a new one.
"Did you report it to the police?" "In Damariscotta right away." Damariscotta was the largest town on the next peninsula north of ours, or east of ours, as Mainers would have it. The town was about 40 minutes from Busman's Harbor at times of the year when there weren't any tourist-related traffic.
I shifted in my chair, preparing to deliver a difficult message. I know it seems like 24 hours is a long time when you've been assaulted and robbed. I can't imagine how you must be feeling. But you need to give the police more time. She waved a hand.
I'm not concerned about the time. The oysters are dead unless the person who robbed me has the equipment and know-how to care for them. I'm concerned the police don't understand the motive.
Don't understand it how? The motive for most robberies seemed pretty straightforward. You have something the other person wants. End of story.
Andie took a deep breath. The police think it was a simple robbery.
She paused.
I think it was an act designed to cripple my business. Sabotage.
A loaded word. My eyebrows jumped involuntarily. Sabotage. How? Who? And why?
That's what I'd like you to help me figure out.
You think someone is out to get you, but you don't know who or why.
Andie nodded. Right. The method was stealing the seed. It doesn't make sense that someone would do it for the money. This was done specifically to hurt me. There's no other explanation for it.
I doodled on the leather-framed paper calendar that functioned as a blotter on my desk, buying time. It was flattering that Chris bragged about my detective skills at his weekly off-season poker game. I had aided the police with their inquiries before, but I still didn't get what exactly Andie's problem had to do with me, or why she had lost faith in her local police so quickly. If there's no explanation aside from sabotage, why do you think the police are convinced it was a simple robbery?
They're distracted by the value of the seed. It's a big number.
How big?
I paid $35,000 cash for those two buckets.
Whoa.
My better judgment screamed at me to shut my mouth, but my curiosity, always the devil on my shoulder, won out.
How do you think I can help?
You can investigate, figure out who hates me that much. Because the seed are so valuable, the police think my robbery was about financial gain for the thief. I'm convinced the motive was to ruin me.
Maybe the person who did this thinks it will put me out of business because if I buy more seed, I might not have the cash I need to hire summer staff and run the business.
Or maybe they hope the damage will be in the long term, that I won't replace the seed and my crop 3 years from now will be too small to sustain me.
She paused.
Neither is true, by the way. I have the cash to replace the seed. It's not the money I'm worried about so much as the motive.
Chris spoke up for the first time since our little meeting had begun. I wasn't sure exactly what you could do, Julia, but I figured you could poke around, like you do, and help Andie figure this out.
This is a different situation. I pushed back but didn't say more.
You've learned from what you've done.
Chris clearly was heavily invested in having me help his friend. The three of us looked from one to the other. I sensed there was something more, something Andie wasn't telling me. But whether her reluctance came because she didn't want to talk in front of Chris or for some other reason, I couldn't tell. Once I'd gotten over my surprise that she wasn't a man, my first impression of her was good. She seemed smart and cool, and she owned and ran a successful oyster farm.
Tell you what, I said. I'll come visit you tomorrow morning and we can talk some more.
No commitment. If I don't think I can help, I'll be honest.
Thank you. Andie gave me an address on the river road, which I wrote on the blotter.
As for the time, you name it. I'm a farmer. I get up with the sun.
I'm not a farmer.
I worked late into the evening most of the year, either running the Snowden Family Clambake dinner service during tourist season or, with Chris, a restaurant that catered to locals in the off-season.
I'll see you at 9:30 tomorrow morning.
Chris walked Andie out. They clumped down the staircase, both in their heavy boots. The old front door of my mother's house creaked open. Goodbyes were spoken. And then I heard a single set of footsteps coming back up the stairs.
You didn't tell me Andie Greatorex is a woman.
Clearly not getting the greeting Chris had been expecting. He rocked back on his heels. His brow crinkled upward with surprise, emphasizing the lines around his deep green eyes. The lines reflected a lot of laughter, a lot of pain, and a life lived outdoors.
Of course she's a woman.
How would I know that? On the rare occasions when you do mention her, it's always Andie this, Andie that. I pictured a guy.
I sounded annoyed, because I was. Everyone around here knows Andie, he insisted. That shut me up for a minute. I'd grown up in Busman's Harbor, but I'd been away for boarding school, college, grad school, and work. It was the beginning of my third season back in town running my family clambake's business. People forgot I didn't know everything. Why did you bring her here? How do you think I can help her? Chris looked surprised. It's what you do, isn't it? Help people who've been involved in crimes. I've never quite heard it put that way. I have in the past helped the state police major crimes unit with investigations, but my principal contribution was local knowledge. I don't know anything about Damariscotta. I don't know the cops there. It's a whole other thing. Chris sat in one of the guest chairs, his long legs sprawled in front of him. Julia, I wouldn't ask, but Andie's seriously upset. She's a good friend, an old friend, and you like to investigate. At least you appear to. And it's a good time for you to do it. By it's a good time, he meant it was a quiet time for year business-wise. We had shut down our business, Gus's too, which we ran as a place for local people to have a meal or a drink during the off-season when everything else was closed. And the Snowden Family Clambake hadn't started up yet. But that doesn't mean I wasn't busy. I looked at the employment applications fanned out on my desk. I had critical positions to fill at the Clambake before we opened in 10 short days, and I had suppliers to find, including a new primary supplier for our steamers, the soft-shell clams that gave the bake its name. But Chris was right. My schedule was more flexible now than it would be at any time until the fall. Are all the people in your poker game women? Chris laughed, and I did too. Andie is the only one. You know Sam, for heaven's sake. Sam Rockmaker was Chris's boss at Crowley's, Busman's Harbor's noisiest, most touristy bar, where he worked as a bouncer evenings, his third job during the tourist season. I looked down at the mess on my desk, and then up at Chris, who remained relaxed, casually sprawled in the chair. Was there ever anything between you and Andie? Even though it made me sound like a jealous nutcase, it was a reasonable question. Chris of the long, rangy body, tasseled hair, green eyes, and freaking chin dimple, was as my mother originally described him, too handsome for his own good. He'd been my middle school crush when he was a senior, a football captain, an all-around high school god. No one had been more astonished than me when we'd gotten together after I returned to town. The interim period had given Chris a decade and a half as a free-range bachelor. I never quite got used to being stopped all over town by women asking, "How's Chris?" or telling me to say hi to Chris. That sort of thing had settled down a good deal over the past year, but it was still there. Chris, to his credit, was incredibly patient and supportive about my little freakouts about his past. Absolutely not. Andie and I have been friends for ages, but only friends. I nodded. I like her. I think we could be friends, too. Chapter 2. The next morning at 9:32 a.m., my navy blue Subaru wagon bumped up the long, narrow private road to Great River Oysters. I'd seen the Great River sign out on the river road hundreds of times as I'd driven from Busman's Harbor to Damariscotta, but I'd never visited the business. At work, I had my hands full of clams and lobsters. I didn't know a thing about oysters. Andie's company was housed in two connected wooden buildings painted white. There was a retail outlet for the oysters and barn-like structure that looked like it was used for packing and shipping. A few picnic tables were scattered on a flat piece of lawn, presumably for people who purchased oysters and wanted to eat them on the spot. A sign on the door to the store said, "Closed," but a red pickup truck and a beat-up Toyota stood in the dirt parking area. As I approached, a kid came out. He looked young, and I wondered momentarily why he wasn't in school, but decided he could be a recent high school graduate or a college student already out for the summer. "Are you Julia? Andie's expecting you. She's down on the dock." "Thanks." He pointed me to a dirt road that descended steeply toward the river. There was a strip of woods about 100 yards wide on my left as I walked. Through the bright spring leaves, I could see the start of a neighbor's lawn on the other side of it. As I came around a curve at the bottom of the road, a large dock complex with a shed on it came into view. Julia! Andie stood on the end of the dock, taking off a wetsuit. Thanks for coming. Happy to. This is quite an operation. Andie finished removing the suit and hung it to dry. Let me show you around. She had a bright red two-piece bathing suit on under the wetsuit. She stepped into a pair of khaki shorts and pulled on a blue cotton shirt as she spoke. The day was bright and sunny, but it was still May in Maine. That morning, I'd put my jeans on as usual, but instead of my uniform of flannel shirt over t-shirt, I put on a nice pink top and a navy blue cardigan. Instead of boots, I'd worn a pair of navy flats I usually reserved for when I was hosting at Gus's, too. Andie looked a little underdressed to me, but she'd just come out of some very cold water. As we walked down the dock, I was conscious of how Andie towered over me. I'm small, but strong from my work at the clambake. Andie, in her looks and movement, radiated power. Whoever had attacked her had a heck of a lot of nerve. She led me from the main dock to an attached floating platform, opened a white box suspended in the water, stuck in a hand, and pulled out a handful of sand. These are baby oysters, she said, a week older than the ones that were stolen. I bent closer so I could see. They look like quinoa, she laughed. Everybody says that. How many oysters is that? I pointed to her hand. This? Maybe 5,000? At this stage, there are 60,000 of them in each upweller. And that's an upweller? These are upwellers. She pointed to the white box, which truly was the size of a bread box, and five others like it. They're nurseries for baby oysters, she explained. The upwellers hang from the dock, and a pump system pushes water through to make sure the oysters get plenty of nutrients. She returned the handful to the box. Well-fed baby oysters grow like crazy. They double in size every day, and they make a lot of poop. Every other day, we open each upweller, shift and sort the oysters, and rinse away the poop. A lot of the poop will be pushed out by the pumps, but a lot will remain. Some oysters grow faster than others, and we move those to another upweller to try to keep similar sizes together. And this is what was stolen from you? Yes, the seed intended for those two upwellers. She pointed to two boxes on the end of the row. We stagger starting the seed in the spring, partly because it's so much work to get them going, and partly to spread out the sizes a little. What would happen to the seed if it wasn't cared for properly? It would die, she pursed her lips, and be worthless to anyone. Where do you get it? From the hatchery. There's one here on the river, another one over on Muscongas Bay. Pretty much every farm on the river uses one or both. Andie looked across the Damariscotta to rows of black boxes floating on the clear water. Those are the cages we move them to. The river was wide at that point. The nearest cages were about 15 yards from the bank on our side. There were cages floating near the other bank as well. There was plenty of room for boats to pass in between them. After 3 months or so, we moved the oysters from the upwellers to the cages, Andie said. Do you want to see? She led me to the boat tied up at the end of the dock. A utilitarian sort of a thing with an inboard motor and plastic crates piled up in the back. I helped with the lines, and we motored into the river. I'd been on a boat on the Damariscotta River many times and always loved it. The day was gorgeous, the sky bright. High white clouds drifted on a field of deep blue. There was something so relaxing and entrancing about the river. I lived and worked on the ocean, which was a beautiful, wild thing, but even on a calm day, it had to be approached with caution. The river cradled you in its banks and protected you. We headed out to strings of floating black cages. Each was about the size and shape of a trombone case. There were groups of them together in many parts of the river, easily visible from where we were. How many oyster farms are there on the Damariscotta? I asked. Five others, six including Great River, and Midden Bay, but they haven't started harvesting yet. They're new. And you all get along? Andie steered the boat over to a triple row of cages. Yes, we work together to keep the environment clean. We talk a lot of business, comparing costs and approaches. The other owners are really the only people in the world who understand my life. Our crews all know each other and party together all summer. By the end of the season, they're all great friends. She paused. At least that's what I've always thought. But now you have doubts. The seed is only valuable to someone who has the equipment and knows how to take care of it. Can you think of someone in particular? I asked. A farmer who resents you or is angry at you for some reason. She paused. These people are my friends. Some of them are really good friends. That's why I prefer to think it was someone who hoped to put me out of business, who didn't care if the oyster seed died. Who would want to put you out of business? She didn't answer. Instead, she used a hook out to pull one of the floating cages toward the boat. She flipped it open and extracted a mesh bag filled with silver dollar-sized oysters. After the upwellers, we move the oysters to these cages, and then when they're big enough, we plant them on the bottom. How long will they be in the cages? 3 to 4 months? These guys will be here most of the summer. And then you just chuck them? She laughed. Onto the bottom in the area of the river where our lease is, yes. But that's tens of thousands of dollars worth of oysters. I couldn't imagine throwing that kind of money off the side of a boat. She laughed. We lose some, but oysters grow where they're planted. They're not like clams. They can't move. A nice piece of hard bottom makes an oyster happy. The bottom in a lot of the river is clay, perfect for oysters. And then what happens? A couple of years later, I come along in my wetsuit and scuba gear and pick them up. You harvest them all by hand? I do. It clearly made her proud. When oysters are farmed in tidal bays, the water may get shallow enough to harvest them walking on the bottom, wearing waders. But the Damariscotta never gets that shallow. Most of the farms along the river do some dive harvesting, but also use draggers. But those are tough on the oysters, tough on other critters, and tough on the bottom. I know exactly what I'm looking for, and I only take what I can use. Great River Oysters has a fabulous reputation. Almost all my customers are top-flight restaurants. My chefs demand an oyster that looks beautiful and tastes amazing. We have a reputation for delivering exactly that. She was so proud of her business. I was impressed by her. Are there oysters right under us now? Andie shook her head. We plant them in a part of our leasehold that's farther out toward the ocean, and therefore colder and saltier. It takes them longer to mature when the water is cold, but they taste even better. As she steered us back toward the Great River dock, I sat in the boat and watched the banks go by. There were big old houses with enormous lawns and smaller summer cottages built by families of more modest means. There were year-round houses where people who worked on the river and in town lived. Lobstermen, oyster farmers, restaurant owners, shopkeepers, and retirees. Wedged in here and there were enormous new houses built in this era, where the rich kept getting richer. Every one of them, from mansion to tiny, unwinterized cottage, would have the same beautiful view and access to the river. From our vantage point in the boat, I spotted something on the bank I hadn't noticed on land. A compact two-story bungalow with a deep screened-in porch in the woods between the Great River buildings and the big house next door. Who lives there? I pointed. I do. The store, shipping barn, and my cottage were originally outbuildings for that big house beyond the tree line. I followed her finger to a shingle-style summer house with a wide lawn and a modest dock on the river. Its weathered shingles were dark gray, its trim painted dark brown. It had the turrets and bay windows typical of its style. It was enormous, a three-story creepy castle dominating the landscape. Living on the farm property makes my life simpler, Andie said. Also, I love my house. It has the same view I look at all day, but on a summer evening, put me on that porch with a beer, listening to Roseanne Cash, watching the eagles and seals. Nothing is better. Nothing is better. I felt the same way about Morro Island, where we ran our clam bakes. Andie had cut the motor, and we drifted on the river. The Damariscotta is tidal. There's always a strong current, but Andie seemed in command. How's Chris doing? She asked. The change of subject surprised me. Fine, I think. That's good to hear, Andie responded. because that whole thing with his brother was intense. And I'm sure it brings up all the stuff he's had to deal with related to his mom and her Huntington's disease. You know about that? I was stunned. Chris had only told me the previous spring that his mother had Huntington's, and there was a 50-50 chance he had it too. And that was after we'd been living together for 2 years. Yeah, I know about it, Andie said. Chris and I go way back. Another piece of distracting information. We floated a little longer, each of us lost in our thoughts. Then I took advantage of the quiet to ask her the question that had nagged at me since the day before. Andie, I can tell you have a theory about why this robbery happened. If you want me to help you, you have to tell me what it is. Wordlessly, Andie guided the boat to a wooden float in the middle of the river and tied us up to it. There were lobster buoys in the water, along with oyster cages belonging to multiple farms. But it was early in the season and we had the place to ourselves. You know more than you're telling me, I insisted. You have an idea about who robbed you, even if you don't have facts. I can't help if you're not straight with me. I'm sorry, she said. I hate thinking about this. I hate thinking that someone I know wants to hurt my business. But you do have an idea why, I pressed her. I've applied to quadruple my lease holdings on the river. It will take me from being a small boutique operation to be the largest in the area. Some people don't like it. Now we were getting somewhere. What people specifically? Lots of people. For example, some of the other oyster farmers are nervous about the application. Why? They're worried that after granting my lease, the state will think there's too much area on the river used for aquaculture and the other farmers won't be allowed to expand. Is there anyone who's particularly anxious? I asked. Or who has threatened you? No. I swear. Anyone else? The lobstermen aren't happy with more of the river going to aquaculture, she answered. They think we're horning in on their bottom. I know lobstermen work the river, but lobsters live in salt water, and river water is fresh. The river is fresh at its source, Damariscotta Lake, but because it's tidal, it gets saltier as it gets closer to the sea. This part of the river is brackish, a mix perfect for oysters, but lobsters can live here too. Is there a lobster man who is particularly upset about your plan to expand, or one you're afraid of? She shook her head, but I didn't believe her. She definitely felt threatened by someone, but I couldn't tell if she was lying to me or to herself. Who else? I asked. Some of the homeowners along the river don't want any more leases. The truth is, they'd like us gone completely, but they know the oyster farms have been too successful to get rid of. They see my lease application as something of a last stand. Why do the homeowners object? I didn't get it. The oyster farms were quiet neighbors. They provided jobs and attracted tourists who filled the businesses downtown. It's some of the summer people with the big houses. They don't like the way the cages look. They claim the oyster poop pollutes the river when really oysters are filter feeders who clean the water. And they say our cages, floats, and whatnots get in the way of their fancy sailboats. Sounds ridiculous. It is, Andie shuddered. But I don't want to think it was any of these people. But there's a hearing on my lease application 2 days from now, and I believe the robbery of my oyster seed was a warning. You think the robbery was meant to intimidate you into withdrawing the lease application, not to put you out of business, I confirmed. That's slightly different. I don't know, she said. Some people, a tiny minority, won't be happy until we're all gone. I nodded, taking it all in. Tell me exactly what happened when you were robbed. Monday morning, I drove back from picking up the spat at the hatchery. Which hatchery? Crane's Oystery, right here in town. I nodded. Go on. I drove my truck all the way down to the dock. The buckets are heavy. I didn't want to carry them down the hill. She hesitated. Did you sense anyone following you? Absolutely not. Her ponytail whipped from side to side as she shook her head. And then what? I got out of the truck, opened the back, and pulled out the buckets. That's when it happened. A man dashed out of the woods and grabbed both buckets. I shouted and got a hold of his sweatshirt. He turned and kicked me in the stomach. I went down on the ground, hard. He ran back into the woods and disappeared. It was over in a matter of seconds. We both turned and looked at the strip of woods. Dense with trees and new spring undergrowth, it extended from the riverbank up the hill and out of sight, the green broken only by Andy's cottage. Describe the man. He was dressed in black, black jeans, black hoodie. He wore a black ski mask. Tall or short, slim or heavy, young or old. Tall, lean, but strong. I didn't see his face, but from the way he moved, I think he was young. Did you recognize him? I mean, despite the mask, did he seem the slightest bit familiar? No! Her response raised several questions, but I stayed on the main path. Which way did he run? Andie stood up in the boat and pointed toward the shore. I parked my truck at the bottom of the road next to the dock. I was at the back of it when he assaulted me. He ran off through the woods toward my house. Is there access to the road directly from your house? Could he have had a vehicle parked there? No. To get to my cottage, you come up the farm road. There's a turnoff to the house right before you come to the shop. He could have stayed in the trees all the way to River Road, Andie said. I assume he had a vehicle parked there. But he could also have run across my neighbor's lawn. I was on the ground. I couldn't see far. Did you see a strange vehicle parked on the River Road when you turned into the farm road? Not that I remember, but I'm not sure that's something I would have taken note of. Do you have security cameras around the farm? There's nothing of value. Some knickknacks in the shop and whatever cash is in the till. The oysters are the only thing worth money, and we ship them out the day they're harvested. I've never seen any reason for a lot of security. The upwellers are worth money, I pointed out. Or what's in them is. I know. Andie sighed. It didn't occur to me that anyone would steal them. Okay. What did you do after the guy ran? I got up, dusted myself off, and then went as fast as I could go to the truck to get my phone, which was in the console by the driver's seat. I called 911. When the dispatcher heard I'd been attacked, she kept me on the line until the officers arrived. How long did that take? Maybe 7 to 10 minutes. Two separate patrol cars came, one cop in each. They took all the information and searched the woods and the road, but the guy was long gone. They asked if I wanted to go to the hospital, but by then I could tell I wasn't hurt badly. What did the police say they were going to do? They informed the local oyster farms to report anyone who came along offering them cheap seed. They took photos of the extra buckets I have in the shed and asked their officers to be on the lookout for ones that looked like mine. They said they'd check around to see if anyone had heard anything. Andie shrugged. Nothing so far on any of those fronts. At least not that they've told me about. I considered where to take the conversation next. Who knew you were picking up the seed on that day, at that time? Andie crossed her tan arms and thought. People at the hatchery, I suppose. When you place your order, you tell them the date and time you'll show up, so the order is ready. It could have been someone from the hatchery who robbed you. I suppose. They'd be one of the few places that could take care of the seed and therefore realize the value. But even if it was a rogue employee, if they did it to more than one customer, it wouldn't take long to figure out what was happening. Either you're the beginning of a crime wave, or I was specifically targeted, Andie finished. I think that's more likely it. What about your employees? Did they know you'd gone to pick up the seed? Andie frowned. It wasn't pleasant to think about people you knew and trusted doing something like this. I have a really small crew right now. I'm in the process of staffing up for the summer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.